Over 50 years ago, the official war on cancer was declared. Since then, treatment and survival rates have soared, and innovative treatments and breakthroughs are no longer a rarity. Glioblastoma, the most common primary brain cancer, a cancer that starts in the brain, is still without a cure. And the five-year survival rate is only around 10%. But a new clinical trial has many goals. One of them is teaching the brain's immune system how to fight the cancer.
It was a Ziploc bag. Out of the blue, Ike Hudson was having trouble opening it. That was one sign. Then,
I had a grand mal seizure on the way to see my personal physician.
After a series of tests and scans, Ike was diagnosed with stage 4 glioblastoma.
Well, I was in the hospital, and I really had no concept or understanding of what glio was at that time. It was like, you have glioblastoma, WHO level 4. And I'm going, okay. okay.
Glioblastoma is one of the most aggressive tumors that people can face, period. And certainly it's the most aggressive tumor of the brain.
Emory neurosurgeon Dr. Aja Ndome says glioblastoma spreads into the surrounding brain, making it impossible to remove the entire tumor with surgery.
Glioblastoma broadly is an almost uniformly fatal disease.
Dr. Ndome researched glioblastoma at the National Institutes of Health before he came to Emory.
No matter how good of a surgery that I do, there are always going to be some tumor cells right next to the normal cells that I can't take out surgically. And that's where treatments come in.
Hudson had surgery and chemotherapy and radiation. Over a year later, a scan shows something that could be a reoccurrence of the cancer.
He has a lesion that, unfortunately, based on the imaging, looks like it's come back.
If the cancer comes back, what was done the first time might be repeated: surgery, radiation, chemotherapy. But this time, Ike Hudson has a new option.
All right, we're good then.
That's because Dr. Ndome is determined to take glioblastoma from fatal to treatable. Dr. Ndome invited Hudson to be in a new trial.
What we're trying to do is take one of our most promising combinations of immune therapies, things that harness the immune system, the part of your body that fights off different infections and bacteria and that sort of thing, but to try and turn that towards the tumor, make it see the tumor and attack the tumor more effectively.
The day before the first of two surgeries, Ike and his wife, Renee,
just some coffee.
Thank you.
Sit on their porch, their life's dreams reduced to one thing.
See the grandkids grow up, having him around. I don't want you around a whole lot longer, because I don't want to do it without you.
Instead of just going right in and taking that tumor out, we're instead going to first confirm that this is actually a representation of tumor that's come back. We just make a very small cut on the head. We use our neuronavigation for the brain to tell us exactly where we are. We take a piece of it. We walk it off to the pathologist. The pathologist will be able to tell us right there whether it looks like this is a tumor that has come back or it doesn't.
Let me see the drill.
The area in question is about a centimeter and a half in size. After drilling a small hole in Hudson's skull, they take a sample of the lesion.
So we just took two pieces of the lesion that we're going to walk over to pathology now and just make sure that we know what we're dealing with.
Less than 15 minutes later, Dr. Ndome and his team have the answer.
Now, we did see some signs of treatment response, which you expect to see for any patient that's had radiation in the past. There'll be some inflammatory cells, and they were there. But we also saw a lot of very atypical cells that are consistent with recurrent glioblastoma. So the pathologist was able to make the call that, unfortunately, Mr. Hudson's tumor has come back.
With the confirmation that the glioblastoma has returned, Ndome is going to place two small catheters in this first surgery.
We will place something called a microdialysis catheter, which is a small tube that's specifically designed to allow certain substances that are in the brain tissue to go into the catheter. When you put a certain fluid into it called the perfusate, that seems similar to the cells around the brain, okay? So I put that fluid in slowly. The substances in the brain are allowed to diffuse across the membrane, and then the fluid comes out slowly and we collect it. And in that way, I'm actually able to get a sampling of what the substances in the brain look like on a minute-to-minute, hour-to-hour basis.
This will allow Dr. Endome to measure what Hudson's immune system is saying. A second catheter is placed in the fluid-filled spaces of Hudson's spine, which also communicates with the brain. This is critically important for what comes next.
Very good. All right. Today's a big day as far as the protocol is concerned. As you know, the main thing we're trying to figure out is whether these immune therapy drugs work in the brain. And today is the day that we actually give him one of the immune therapy drugs, one of these checkpoint inhibitors, and then we'll give him some time to let his body respond and see if we can measure a response to it. So the infusion is going to happen this afternoon.
Hudson remains in the hospital after surgery so that he can receive a combination of checkpoint inhibitors.
All right, we're good to go with the infusion.
First, Dr. Endome is going to take samples from the tubes in Hudson's brain to see how the immune system in the brain is communicating before treatment.
I'm going to change out those tubes that we're measuring to get a baseline of what the immune microenvironment of his brain looks like, how the brain's kind of talking to itself from an immune standpoint.
You have your infusion.
The infusion will not be delivered through the catheters.
When they think of putting a catheter into the brain for a brain tumor trial, a lot of people think that what we're doing is putting a drug directly into the brain. And that's not the case here. That is the case for some studies. In this case, we're actually taking a drug that is usually given in the bloodstream, in the periphery, with the thought that it will stimulate the immune system and have an effect on the brain, and using our catheters to measure the response to that therapy in the brain.
Again, we'll be checking on you, okay?
Samples from the catheter in Hudson's brain will be taken every 6 hours. A sample from the cerebral spinal fluid and a blood sample will be taken once a day. At the end of the week, Hudson will undergo the second surgery to remove tumor regrowth.
We have the ultrasound up. The surface of the brain is a couple different colors. Let me see the stealth probe one more time.
Emory was the first institution in the country to use Gliolan, a substance that literally makes tumors light up.
To the naked eye as well, the fluorescence says, hey, yeah, this is a problem. So this is the most obvious kind of biggest nodule we're looking at the beginning. You can see the surface of the brain there. This is kind of a smaller nodule that was nearby. And what I'm going to do is just make sure that we've given enough to our pathologist to make a good diagnosis.
It's a little pink with the glial.
Dr. Endome removes the tumor regrowth. He will compare this tissue with the tumor tissue taken from the first surgery before Hudson received the immunotherapy.
It turns out
Dr. Endome hopes to detect some change in the immune microenvironment of the tumor. The hope for Ike Hudson and the other patients in this trial is to live longer. Part of Dr. Endome's hope comes from a different trial at UCLA that showed something unexpected.
They saw a survival benefit for patients that got the drug before their tumor was taken out. Why did they see a survival benefit for that subset of patients? We don't know the answer to that yet. We're still trying to figure that out. There is some speculation that maybe you need to give the immune therapeutic to boost the immune system. Then the immune cells that are in the tumor itself then get educated against what the tumor looks like and how to attack it. And then you take out the tumor and reduce the amount of tumor that's there, but the immune system remembers, which there is this concept of immune memory. That's how vaccines work. That's how if you get a cold the next time, hopefully you're able to fight it off better.
It will be many months before Dr. Endome and his team know what the immunotherapy did or didn't do for the trial participants. Even the smallest change will provide profound insight in a disease and diagnosis viewed as hopeless. It moves the science one step closer to effective treatments.
What do you want to do after you get home and you get well?
The worst diagnosis makes things clear.
Biggest concern is how it affects my family. I have 3 very beautiful granddaughters, one of which is 10 months old and has no concept. and one who's 7 and one who's 5. And they don't understand why Papa is not feeling well.
The worst diagnosis is also a magnet for physician scientists like Dr. Ndome, determined to change the outcome.
I've always been interested in big challenges. And my parents had told me when I was little that I could be anything that I wanted to be, and I could be successful at anything that I wanted to be successful at. And I always knew I wanted to do something that was difficult. I mean, if I had all that ability, why not use that ability on something that had been a challenge, something that had been facing mankind for a long time?
Ike Hudson remained on immunotherapy for 5 months. He continues treatment for his tumor, and the study team is hopeful that his prolonged treatment with immune therapy will lead to a long tumor-free interval. Dr. Ndome's samples are undergoing definitive processing. Results of the trial will be known in early 2024.